These are African rhythms, passed down to us through ancient spirits. Feel the spirit, a unifying force. Come on, move with the spirit. Stand up, clap your hands.
From WSNC 90.5 FM, a broadcasting service of Winston-Salem State University, welcome to Africa World Now Project. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. Today, explorations in democracy, radical humanism, and the role and responsibilities of revolutionaries, national sovereignty, and third world solidarity with Che Guevara in his own words. Africa World Now Project is next. Control of information, the foundation of knowledge formation, is a crucial tool of oppression. The manufactured ignorance of the masses has been utilized to create a globalized order that positions one group of people against another group of people. Nevertheless, the reality suggests that groups of people who are in bitter conflict with each other actually have more in common than differ. The methods to free oneself from not knowing and ignorance are manifold and bound by the conditions within which this ignorance is formed. The Cuban Revolution was one in a protracted line of resistance movements in world historical moments when the people decided to move beyond their manufactured realities. Che Guevara is undeniably one of the chief architects of this moment. The influence of Che is displayed in his December 11, 1964 UN speech, where he proclaimed that Cuba comes here to state its position on the most important points of controversy and will do so with the full sense of responsibility that the use of this podium implies, while at the same time fulfilling the unavoidable duty of speaking clearly and frankly. We would like to see this assembly shake itself out of complacency and move forward. We would like to see the committees begin their work and not stop at first confrontation. Imperialism wants to turn this meeting into a pointless oratorical tournament instead of solving the serious problems of the world. We must prevent it from doing so. This session of the assembly should not be remembered in the future solely by the number 19 that identifies it. Our efforts are directed to that end. We feel that we have the right and the obligation to do so because our country is one of the most constant points of friction. It is one of the places where the principles upholding the right of small countries to sovereignty are put to the test day by day, minute by minute. At the same time, our country is one of the trenches of freedom in the world, situated a few steps away from U.S. imperialism, showing by its actions, its daily example, that in the present conditions of humanity, the peoples can liberate themselves and keep themselves free. Of all the burning problems to be dealt with by this assembly, one of the special significance for us, and one whose solution we feel must be found first, so as to leave no doubt in the minds of anyone, is that the peaceful coexistence among states with different economic and social systems. Much progress has been made in the world in this field, but imperialism, particularly U.S. imperialism, has attempted to make the world believe that peaceful coexistence is the exclusive right of the Earth's great power. It is vital that we interrogate the forms of knowledge with which we use to understand our past and present, as the answers we collect are directly related to how we move toward the future. In short, it is essential to consistently think about the way that we think, ask individual and collective critical questions. The ideas that are formed are only dangerous to those who seek to control the lived reality of the masses. Their innate distrust of the masses to think in opposition to question the legitimacy of their coerced authority places those in perceived positions of power in a constant state of alarm and fear. Until we understand the ideas centered on a humane and collective trajectory to bring peace to manufactured conflict, and that this is naturally evolutionary and dialectical, we will continually be forced to give coerced consent and legitimacy to fear-based policies and systems. The use of imagination, human creativity, and the yearning to develop a human paraxis to address social, economic, political inequities must be our weapons. The more we seek the continuities in our experiences, the closer we come to a reconstructed world. This has been and still is the central premise of African world historical movements. Cuba has without doubt shown material and ideological effect on this premise. Let's listen to Che Guevara's ideas on democracy, radical humanism, etc., in his own words, unfiltered. What you will hear on today's program first is an excerpt of Che's December 11, 1964 speech at the 19th General Assembly of the United Nations in New York. Then we will hear a December 16, 1964 informal interview Che gave several journalists at the Cuba Mission Headquarters in New York, narrated by journalist Chris Couch. Lastly, we will hear a segment of a panel interview Che participated in on Face the Nation on December 13, 1964. Our show is produced today in solidarity with the Native, Indigenous, and Afro-descendant communities of Standing Rock, Venezuela, Corporation Jackson in Jackson, Mississippi, Brazil, the Avalon Village in Detroit, Colombia, Kenya, Palestine, South Africa, and Ghana, and other places who are fighting for the protection of our land for the benefit of all people. Enjoy the program.
También hay que esclarecer que no solamente en relaciones en las cuales están imputados estados soberanos.
We must also say that it is not only in relations between sovereign states that the concept of peaceful coexistence must be clearly defined. As Marxists, we have maintained that peaceful coexistence among nations does not encompass coexistence between the exploiters and the exploited, the oppressor and the oppressed.
Es además un principio proclamado en el seno de esta organización.
Furthermore, a principle proclaimed by this organization is that of the right to full independence of all forms of colonial oppression. That is why we express our solidarity with the colonial peoples of so-called Portuguese Guinea, Angola, and Mozambique, who have been massacred for the crime of demanding their freedom, and we are prepared to help them to the extent of our ability in accordance with the Cairo Declaration.
La brutal política del apartheid se aplica ante los ojos.
The brutal policy of apartheid is being carried out before the eyes of the whole world. The peoples of Africa are being compelled to tolerate in that continent the concept, still official, of the superiority of one race over another, and in the name of that racial superiority, the murder of people with impunity. Can the United Nations do nothing to prevent this? I should like specifically to refer to the painful case of the Congo, unique in the history of the modern world, which shows how, with absolute impunity, with the most insolent cynicism, the rights of people can be flouted. The prodigious wealth of the Congo, which the imperialist nations wish to maintain under their control, is the direct reason for this.
En la intervención que hubiera de hacer a raíz de su primera visita a las Naciones Unidas,
in his speech on his first visit to the United Nations, our comrade Fidel Castro said that the whole problem of coexistence among peoples The whole problem of coexistence among peoples was reduced to the undue appropriation of another's wealth. He said, when this philosophy of despoilment disappears, the philosophy of war will have disappeared as well. The philosophy of despoilment not only has not ceased, but rather it is stronger than ever. And that is why those who use the name of the United Nations to commit the murder of Lumumba today, in the name of the defense of the white race, are assassinating thousands of Congolese. How can one forget how the hope that Patrice Lumumba placed in the United Nations was betrayed. How can one forget the machinations and maneuvers which followed in the wake of the occupation of that country by United Nations troops, under whose auspices the assassins of this great African patriot acted with impunity? But the scales have fallen from our eyes, and they now open upon new horizons. And we can see what yesterday, in our conditions of colonial servitude, we could not observe. That Western civilization disguises under its showy front a scene of hyenas and of jackals. That is the only name that can be applied to those who have gone to fulfill humanitarian tasks in the Congo. Bloodthirsty butchers who feed on helpless people. That is what imperialism does to men. That is what marks the white imperialist. The free men of the world must be prepared to avenge the crime committed in the Congo. We want to build socialism. We have declared ourselves partisans of those who strive for peace. We have declared ourselves as falling within the group of non-aligned countries, although we are Marxist-Leninists, because the non-aligned countries, like ourselves, fight imperialism. We want peace. We want to build a better life for our people. And that is why we avoid answering, so far as possible, the planned provocations of the Yankee. But we know the mentality of United States rulers. They want to make us pay a very high price for that peace. We reply that that price cannot go beyond the bounds of human dignity. Specifically, United States forces took part in the repression of the peoples of Venezuela, Colombia, and Guatemala, who carry on an armed struggle for their freedom. In Venezuela, not only do the Americans advise the army and the police, but they also direct acts of genocide from the air against the peasant population in vast rebel-held areas. And the United States companies established there exert pressures of every kind to increase direct interference.
Los imperialistas se preparan a reprimir a los pueblos americanos.
The imperialists are preparing to repress the peoples of America and are setting up an international network of crime. The United States interfered in America while invoking the defense of free institutions. The time will come when this assembly will acquire greater maturity and demand guarantees from the United States government for the lives of the black and Latin American population who reside in that country, most of whom are native-born or naturalized United States citizens. How can they presume to be the guardians of liberty when they kill their own children and discriminate daily against people because of the color of their skin? When they not only free the murderers of black people, but even protect them while punishing the black population because they demand their legitimate rights as free men? But it must be clearly established that the government of the United States is not the champion of freedom, but rather the perpetrator of exploitation and oppression of the peoples of the world and of a large part of its own population.
Allez.
To the equivocating language with which some delegates have painted the case of Cuba and the Organization of American States, we reply with blunt words that the governments pay for their treason.
Cobrarán a los gobiernos entreguistas su traición. Cuba, señores delegados,
Cuba, a free and sovereign state, with no chains binding it to anyone, with no foreign investments on its territory, with no proconsuls orienting its policy, can speak proudly in this assembly, proving the justice of the phrase by which we will always be remembered. Free territory of America.
Listening to Che Guevara's ideas on democracy, radical humanism, decolonization, in his own words, unfiltered. We have just listened to an excerpt of Che's December 11, 1964 speech at the 19th General Assembly of the United Nations in New York. Next, we will hear a December 16, 1964 informal interview Che gave to several journalists at the Cuba Mission headquarters in New York, narrated by journalist Chris Koch. And lastly, we will hear a segment of a panel interview Che participated in on Face the Nation on December 13, 1964, where he faced a barrage of questions. Enjoy the rest of the program.
Chris Koch. On Wednesday night, December 16th, a group of American socialist journalists and writers spent about an hour talking with Comandante Che Guevara at the Cuban Mission here in New York. I was there with a microphone and tape recorder, and this program will be a report of that meeting with the Cuban Minister of Industry. East 67th Street between Madison and Fifth Avenue was blocked off by barricades and a handful of policemen. The group of writers who had met at a restaurant in the neighborhood were stopped by police at the corner. We waited until clearance came from the Cuban Mission building near the center of the block, then walked into a large townhouse through a tight line of New York's finest, making comments and nudging us as we tried to get through the door. We waited in a storeroom for about a half an hour and then went upstairs, into a large room with a high ceiling, a desk, a marble fireplace, chandeliers, and three sofas, partially surrounding a large coffee table. The writers ranged themselves on the sofa, and Comandante Guevara knelt on the floor in front of the table. Those standing soon settled down on the floor around the table next to him. Comandante Guevara was dressed in pressed military fatigues and polished black boots. During the conversation, he was in constant motion, lying on his side, shifting to a squatting position, back to his side, resting his head on his hands, and puffing constantly on a cigar. Constant motion. Guevara was relaxed, joked much, smiled always. The conversation was hardly orderly, and much of it was of little real use. At least a portion of those present seemed more interested in advice on how to conduct the North American Revolution than on information or analysis of the Cuban, and for a good portion of the discussion, such questions were more revealing than the answers. Guevara, too, quickly sensing that the session would be less than demanding, began to take the questions in a spirit of general humor. Nonetheless, there were portions that may be interesting. I have reorganized the material somewhat and left out several lengthy digressions, and from time to time have rephrased a question. Guevara's answers, however, are unretouched, and presented exactly as they were given. One area of the discussion dealt with his own revolutionary past and his analysis of the Cuban guerrilla struggle.
You are Argentinian by birth, and rather than make a revolution in the Argentine, you went out and, as I understand it, traveled and stayed in several countries before coming into conjunction with Fidel Castro in Mexico. I would like to ask how you look back upon this and see it as some kind of lucky juncture, or that somehow you were searching until a revolutionary situation coalesced, or?
Bueno, es una pregunta más bien de intimidad, así de círculo, después de tres o cuatro coñac y remembranza de otras cosas.
It seems to be a question to be answered after three or four drinks in a more intimate atmosphere.
En general, lo que se puede decir,
in general, what we can, could say,
que hay algunos momentos,
there are some moments
de nuestra revolución,
in our revolution,
que son cosas de loco,
that are things completely mad.
El ataque a Moncada.
The attack against the Moncada barracks.
La salida del Granma.
The expedition of the Granma.
La continuación de la lucha con el grupo de hombres.
The struggle with the handful of men that remain.
La defensa contra la última embestida de la dictadura en la sierra.
The defense against the last great attack by the dictatorship in the sierra, maestra.
La invasión de las villas.
The invasion of the province of Las Villas.
La toma de las principales ciudades.
The seizure of the principal towns.
Cada una de esas cosas se analiza.
If you analyze one, each one of those things,
y se llega a la conclusión de que había loco de por medio.
You reach the conclusion that there was something mad in the middle, something crazy in the middle.
Y como todas ellas concatenadas llevaron a la toma del poder.
And as all of them, as a chain, led to the seizure of power.
Tal vez se podría llegar a la conclusión de que para tomar el poder se necesita ser un poco loco.
You may have to reach the conclusion that in order to seize power you have to be a little crazy.
O por lo menos no tener miedo a lo que vaya a pasar.
Or at least not to be afraid to what may happen.
Que es lo que nosotros no tuvimos, sinceramente.
Which we didn't have, honestly.
At what point did you know that you had won?
¿En qué momento se dieron cuenta de que habían ganado?
Eso ya es una pregunta de una película de la USIS.
That is a question which belongs more to a film by the United States Information Agency.
Someone then asked if audacity and a certain craziness were necessary to make a revolution, how these qualities could be kept and nurtured after the revolution had been successful. How does a government prevent the growth of bureaucracy?
Esa es la pregunta que nosotros nos hacemos.
That is the question that they formulate themselves.
Y buscamos una serie de respuestas.
They seek a series of answers.
Experimento.
Of experimentation.
Pero no podemos contestarles.
But they cannot answer.
Totalmente.
Totally.
Dentro de unos años, sí.
In a few years, yes.
About keeping audacity alive, have there been any changes in Cuban education in terms of preventing youngsters from growing up into small B bureaucrats and into dead souls?
Ha habido un cambio en el sistema educativo de Cuba en el sentido de evitar que los jóvenes se conviertan en pequeños burócratas.
Lo estuvimos discutiendo el otro día, tú.
We were discussing that the other day.
Estás repitiendo las preguntas.
Repeating the questions.
Sí.
Yes, there have been.
Todavía no está estructurado como un sistema.
We have not made a structure out of it as a system.
Pero hay la identidad entre el estudio y el trabajo.
But there is the identification between the studies and the work, labor.
El trabajo de los estudiantes ayudando a determinadas tareas agrícolas.
The students work, they cooperate in certain agricultural works.
El significado de este trabajo.
The meaning of this work.
Por ejemplo, para ir a recoger café.
For example, to collect coffee.
Solamente tienen derecho a ir los que han aprobado todas las asignaturas.
Only those students which have passed all subjects can go.
El trabajo es un premio.
Work is a price.
Los tipos de escuelas.
The kinds of schools.
En lugares difíciles.
In difficult places.
Por ejemplo, la escuela de maestros voluntarios.
For example, the school of voluntary teachers.
En la Sierra Maestra.
In the Sierra Maestra.
Y otras experiencias de ese tipo.
And other experiences of that sort.
Almost all American psychoanalysts say that the social revolutionary as a type is immature and is fighting out infantile problems. Now, you are trained as a psychoanalyst and you are a social revolutionary. Would you care to comment on this view of American?
Yo creo que no hay que buscar.
I don't think we have to look
no hay que ser tan rebuscado en la apreciación de los hechos.
We need not be so detailed in the appreciation of facts.
Los revolucionarios no son gente normal.
The revolutionary people are not normal people.
Eso se lo puedo asegurar.
That I can assure you.
Pero, en definitiva,
but
lo importante es que la capacidad de construcción y de sacrificio.
But in the long run, the important thing is that the capacity for sacrifice
construcción
and construction
se va desarrollando.
Be developed.
El revolucionario hace la revolución.
The revolutionary makes the revolution.
Pero la revolución hace el revolucionario.
But the revolution makes the revolutionary.
Y es una interrelación constante.
And there is an interrelationship, a constant interrelationship.
Donde el revolucionario va alcanzando grados más altos.
Where the revolutionary achieves a higher level of conscience.
¿Por qué empezó? Se lo podemos dejar a los psicoanalistas.
Why did he start? We can leave that to the psychoanalysts.
Pero el hecho final.
But the final fact
es un resultado de la lucha.
Is a result of the struggle
y de la acción de las masas sobre el propio revolucionario.
And of the actions of the masses on the revolutionary himself.
In many ways, the Cuban revolutionary movement has been unique. At this point, do you think there are any lessons from that uniqueness that can be adapted to other revolutionary movements, either in other Latin American countries or here?
No, yo no empleé la palabra caso único.
Oh, I did not employ use the word unique.
Peleo contra la palabra caso único.
I fight against the word unique.
Dije caso de loco.
I said thing, a crazy thing.
Pero loco hay mucho.
But there are a lot of crazy people.
Y las bases sociales que llevan a Cuba a la revolución.
The social basis which carry Cuba onto a revolution.
Y el lugar donde se desarrolla.
And the place where they develop.
Desde el punto de vista de la geografía o de la estructura social.
From the point of view of geography or social structures.
Es muy parecido a los demás países de Latinoamérica.
It's very similar to those of other Latin American countries. They are very similar to those of other countries.
Más todavía.
And even more.
En Venezuela.
In Venezuela.
Se han cometido los mismos errores que nosotros cometimos.
The same mistakes we made have been made.
Y han seguido la misma línea que nosotros seguimos.
And they have followed the same road we follow.
No aprendieron nada, en realidad.
They did not
learn de todos nuestros defectos.
Anything from our mistakes.
Pero van por el buen camino.
But they go in the right direction.
What mistakes specifically do you
make?
El excesivo acento en la lucha en la, por la lucha en las ciudades, por ejemplo.
Too much stress on fighting in towns, within the cities.
Se pierde mucho cuadro.
You lose too many cadres.
Y no se saca dividendo suficiente.
And there is not enough profit.
Espectacular nada más.
It's very spectacular, but that's all.
La alianza con una serie de militares en el intento de golpes.
The alliance with a number of military people in an attempt of coup d'etat.
Como Carúpano en Puerto Cabello.
Like Carúpano en Puerto Cabello.
The discussion also ranged for some time on developments throughout Latin America and an analysis of the various Latin American countries. Guevara was asked at one point whether the United States' allegation that the weapons used in Venezuela by the guerrillas were of Czech manufacture, exported from Cuba. Guevara replied that Cuba did have a lot to do with the problem of Venezuelan weapons, because Cuba had said for a long time that the only way to liberate a country, when you do not have weapons, you have to rise with the weapons you have, and then have to take the rest of the weapons from the enemy. To that extent, he said, they were responsible. He emphasized, time and again, however, when speaking of other Latin American countries, that conditions were different everywhere, had to be analyzed, and that there was no formula for revolutionary struggle. For example, he asked,
would you offer us an analysis of the Brazilian debacle?
It's too much to ask to make an analysis.
Ese es un país que es unos 80 veces más grande que Cuba.
That's a country which is about 80 times the size of Cuba.
Y tiene 10 veces más población.
And 10 times its population.
Nosotros ponernos a hacer un análisis así.
For us to make an analysis like
poquito,
that.
Sería un poquito pretencioso.
Be a little presumptuous.
Lo fundamental.
The fundamental thing.
Es que el gobierno organizaciones de izquierda y las masas populares.
Is that the government and the leftist organizations and the popular masses
confiaron en lo que se llaman las instituciones.
Trusted the so-called institutions.
Y en las instituciones no se pueden confiar.
And institutions cannot be trusted.
A menos que sean de la misma clase.
Unless they belong to the same class.
Y el ejército naturalmente no era de la clase.
And naturally, the army did not belong to the proletariat.
Eso es la síntesis, no el análisis.
I would say that is a synthesis, not an analysis. What does the major think about the case of Puerto Rico? Can it be settled within the UN, or eventually Puerto Rico must have to appeal to the same means as Venezuela, for example?
Bueno, Puerto Rico es un caso distinto al de Venezuela.
Puerto Rico is a different case from that of Venezuela.
Desde el punto de vista de las posibilidades de lucha, de la misma lucha, ¿no?
From the point of view of the struggle itself, or the possibilities for struggle.
Naturalmente es un pueblo colonizado.
And naturally it is a colonial people.
Pero la circunstancia de estar dentro del sistema norteamericano.
What the circumstances of it being within the American system.
Cantidad de puertorriqueños que viven en los Estados Unidos.
The number of Puerto Ricans which live in the U.S.
La presión que hacen sobre toda la cultura del pueblo puertorriqueño.
The pressure made on the whole culture of the Puerto Rican people.
Y en fin, sobre su su idea de pueblo en sí.
And in short, the pressure on its idea as a people
hace que la lucha sea sumamente difícil.
Those circumstances make a struggle very difficult.
Y que si llegara a ser una lucha armada,
and if it may reach the proportions of an armed struggle,
tendría que tomar otras características.
It would have to have other characteristics.
El tamaño de la isla, la
size of the island, the population
impiden hacer una lucha del mismo tipo.
They prevent a similar struggle.
Cuando las condiciones estén maduras,
when conditions are ripe,
y el pueblo de Puerto Rico está en condiciones ya de alcanzar su libertad.
And the people of Puerto Rico are in a position to achieve, to attain its liberty, its freedom.
Si los norteamericanos no ceden.
If the Americans do not yield,
el pueblo encontrará la forma.
The people will find the ways of struggle.
Yo no soy ni un profeta ni un profesor.
I'm neither a prophet nor a professor.
Profesor de liberación.
Nor a professor of liberation.
El pueblo.
It depends on the people. You think there is a man in Puerto Rico that could replace Albizu?
Los hombres nacen de la masa.
The men come from the masses.
La masa está ahí.
And the mass is there.
Ahí tienen que salir.
They have to come from there.
Do you think it will be possible for Latin America to live in peace without the fall of the United States government?
Es una pregunta difícil.
It's a difficult question.
No, por lo menos por ahora lo único que nosotros podemos saber es que va a haber que luchar.
At least for the time being, all we have to know is that there will be a need for fighting, for struggle.
As I said earlier, much of the discussion was an attempt to get an analysis of the United States situation and to give advice on revolutionary tactics here in this country. To one such question, Guevara replied.
How do you see, considering recent events of last summer and the recent events in Mississippi, how do you see the struggle of the Negro people in America?
En vista de los últimos acontecimientos de los acontecimientos del verano pasado, de los últimos acontecimientos en Mississippi, ¿cómo contempla usted la lucha del negro americano en los Estados Unidos?
Esa es una pregunta muy difícil para mí.
That's a very difficult question for me to answer.
Habría que conocer todas las las reacciones del pueblo americano en su conjunto.
We would have to know all the reactions of the American people as a whole.
Las relaciones entre blancos y negros.
The relationships among whites and colored.
La capacidad de reacción de la población negra.
The capacity for reaction among the colored people.
La capacidad de sus líderes.
The capacity of the leaders.
En fin, habría que conocer muy profundamente una serie de aspectos que yo no conozco a fondo.
In short, we would have to know with great detail a lot of aspects which I do not know.
En general, parece que la violencia racial.
In general, it seems that racial violence.
Se está encendiendo en algunos estados norteamericanos.
Is flourishing in some North American states.
Frente a eso hay varios recursos.
In front of that, in the face of that, there are some resources or some means, some ways.
Agachar un poquito más el lomo a ver si duele menos el golpe.
We can crouch a little more to see if the blow hurts less.
Protestar enérgicamente.
We can protest with energy.
Y recibir más golpes.
And then receive more blows. Or
responder golpe por golpe.
Answer blow by blow.
Pero eso se dice fácil.
But that's very easy to say.
Muy difícil de hacer.
And it's very difficult to do.
Y hay que prepararse para hacerlo.
And there must be a preparation in order to do that.
¿Cuál será la reacción? Yo no sé.
I don't know what the reaction will be.
¿Y cuál será la posibilidad de reacción?
And what the possibilities of a reaction would be.
Tampoco puedo decirlo.
I cannot predict them.
More specifically, at one point, Guevara was asked if he would recommend guerrilla warfare in the United States, recognizing that this is a highly developed and urbanized country. Guevara replied.
Ahora sí, pensar en una guerra de guerrillas en Estados Unidos.
But to think about the guerrilla warfare in the U.S.
En todo caso, si me pidieran consejo, yo les haría que.
If you would ask for my advice,
que no se metieran en eso.
I would tell you not to engage.
Y no por simpatía al gobierno.
And not because of sympathy to the government.
Along the same lines, although with perhaps more seriousness, Guevara replied to a question of whether or not the Cuban government planned to start a large propaganda campaign in the United States to reach large numbers of the American people.
Si ahora se quisiera sacar una hoja a afeitar para reemplazar la Gillette.
For example, we would like to try to produce now a shaving, how do you say, a razor blade to replace Gillette.
Necesitaría millones y millones de pesos de propaganda.
You need millions and millions of dollars in propaganda.
Y sería para luchar contra un solo producto.
That would be to fight against only one product.
Ahora hay que ver cuánto necesitaríamos nosotros de propaganda.
We would see how many resources we would need to employ in propaganda.
Para luchar contra todos los productos.
In order to fight against all products.
Que son producto de un sistema.
Which are product of a system.
Todas las cadenas radiales y
all radio
y televisión, periódicos,
newspaper.
No, necesitaríamos la mitad del presupuesto de Estados Unidos.
We would need half the budget of the U.S. in order to carry on that.
Y no lo tenemos.
And we don't have that.
Preferible esperar que el pueblo entienda.
It's better to wait for the people to comprehend.
Porque el pueblo siempre supera las
people on the long run.
Todos los problemas de la propaganda.
Overcomes all the problems of propaganda.
Si a pesar de toda la propaganda que hace la Gillette.
In spite of all the propaganda made by Gillette.
Si fuera igual que la hojita que tenemos nosotros allá en Cuba.
If Gillette was the same kind of blade as the one we have in Cuba.
Nadie la compraría.
Nobody would buy it.
Propaganda tiene sus límites.
Propaganda has its limits.
Y los límites de la propaganda contra Cuba.
And the limits of propaganda against Cuba.
Está en la verdad del pueblo cubano.
Are in the truth held by the Cuban people.
Y la verdad de nuestra revolución.
And the truth of our revolution.
Vamos a esperar.
Let's wait. We can wait.
The other major topic during our conversation with Comandante Guevara was Cuban-American relations. He said that he was sure that eventually normal relations would be restored between Cuba and the United States. He said that Cuba had made numerous attempts to normalize these relations, but that the United States had made none. Asked how a rapprochement might be achieved, Guevara said that he didn't know. I then asked him,
is the United States' attempt to isolate Cuba from other Western countries being more or less successful?
El resto del hemisferio. En cuanto a los gobiernos, ha tenido casi total ya.
With regards to the governments, it has had an almost complete success.
En cuanto a los pueblos, cada vez menos.
With regards to the peoples, every time less success.
How serious is this on the Cuban economy?
¿Qué consecuencias tiene esto para la economía cubana?
No, el aislamiento de Latinoamérica, ninguno.
The isolation from Latin America has no consequences.
Nuestros problemas económicos nacen de dos lugares nada más.
Our economic problems are born in two places.
Los Estados Unidos.
The U.S.
Y a veces nuestras locuras también.
And sometimes our own crazy actions.
La locura esa que nos permite hacer otras cosas.
Those crazy actions which do not permit us to do other things.
Los errores.
Mistakes.
La ignorancia.
Ignorance.
Tomamos un poder, un estado completo.
We took a complete state, we took over a complete state.
Cambiamos todo el aparato estatal.
We changed the whole structure of the state.
Toda la estructura.
The whole system of power.
Y tuvimos que crear toda una cosa nueva.
And we had to create a whole new thing.
Ahí se cometen errores.
You have to make mistakes there.
Esos son nuestros dos enemigos.
Those are our two enemies.
La ignorancia, la improvisación por un lado.
Ignorance to improvise.
Y los Estados Unidos por el otro.
And the U.S. on the other hand.
El primero estamos venciendo.
We are conquering the first mistake. First question.
El segundo también.
And the second too.
The last question of the discussion dealt with what one of the writers called the Chinese position that it was better for underdeveloped countries to improve their economies on the labor of their own people rather than to rely on the economic assistance of the great powers. Guevara replied to this.
Ese es un problema muy, muy delicado para tratar.
It's a very delicate question to deal here.
Cada uno tiene sus razones para actuar de la forma que actúa.
Everyone has own reasons to act the way it does.
Nosotros no confiamos en nuestras propias fuerzas solamente.
We do not only trust our own forces.
Nosotros confiamos en las fuerzas de todo el campo socialista.
We trust the forces of all the socialist bloc.
Y exigimos además.
And we ask furthermore.
Que se nos ayude.
That they help us.
Porque es un deber del internacionalismo proletario.
It's a duty of the international proletariat.
Y es un deber nuestro.
And it's our duty.
Reclamar la ayuda.
To ask for that help.
Porque nuestra lucha no nos pertenece a nosotros
solos. Because our struggle does not belong only to us.
Pertenece a todos los pueblos del mundo.
Belongs to all peoples of the world.
Y no la podemos dejar caer.
And we cannot let it fall.
Major Guevara, in your speech to the General Assembly day before yesterday, you accused the United States of helping Cuba's neighbors prepare new aggression against her. We, in turn, have often accused your government of abetting subversion in other Latin American countries. Do you see any way out of this situation, any way to improve relations?
I think with regards to solutions, there are solutions. And I think there is only one. We have said repeatedly to the government of the U.S. that we do not want anything but to forget us, that they that they do not consider us even for good or evil.
From New York City, Face the Nation, a spontaneous and unrehearsed news interview with Ernesto Che Guevara, Cuban Minister of Industry. Major Guevara will be questioned by CBS News United Nations correspondent Richard C. Hotlett, Ted Schultz of the Washington Bureau of the New York Times, and CBS News correspondent Paul Niven.
Major Guevara, you said a moment ago you would simply like us Americans to forget Cuba. Your speech the other day suggested that you can't forget us. You consider us a hostile government 90 miles away. How can you expect us to forget you?
Yo no dije exactamente que esperaba.
I didn't say exactly that I expected to forget us. You ask a solution, and I said, what was that solution in the present moment? If it's possible or not, that's another question.
Major Guevara, on several opportunities recently, Premier Fidel Castro has suggested in interviews with visiting newspaper men and on other occasions that a new effort be made to normalize relations between Cuba and the United States, particularly in the field of trade and exchanges. As an economist, do you feel yourself that a resumption of relations of this nature would be useful or welcome for Cuba? In other words, would you like to see the relations normalized?
Not as an economist, because I have never considered myself an economist, but only an official of the Cuban government, as another Cuban. I think harmonious relations with the U.S. would be very good for us, from the economical point of view, more than in any other field, because all our industry has been established by the U.S. and primary products and repair parts that we have to make with much difficulty or to bring from other areas could come directly. And besides, sugar, which traditionally we had the American market, is also near.
Major, if my recollection is right, in 1960 you made several speeches, particularly one in March of 1960, saying that for Cuba to go on selling sugar to the United States was a form of colonialism to which Cuba was subjected. Have you changed your mind about this?
Naturally, because those were different conditions. We sold sugar with specific conditions established by American buyers, which in turn dominated the internal market and production in Cuba. Now, if we would sell sugar to the U.S., it would be the Cuban government the one who would sell it, and it would be a complete profit for our people.
Dr. Guevara, Washington has said that there are two political conditions for the establishment of normal relations between the United States and Cuba. One is the abandonment of your military commitment to the Soviet Union. The other is the abandonment of the policy of exporting revolution to Latin America. Do you see any chance of a change in either of these points?
Absolutely. We don't put no condition of any kind to the U.S. We don't want it to change its system. We don't want this racial discrimination to cease in the U.S. We put no conditions to the establishment of relations, but we neither put conditions to...
But my question was whether you would accept these conditions placed by the United States on the resumption of normal relations.
We will not accept any conditions from the U.S. We will not accept conditions imposed by the U.S. to us.
But when, in the matter of the missiles, the Russian missiles on Cuba, and the Cuban military relations with the Soviet Union, how can the United States be sure that Cuba is not a strategic threat once again? Would you accept United Nations inspection or inspection by the Organization of American States if you do not permit American on-site inspection of Cuba?
You talked about the Organization of American States. Yesterday, the day before yesterday, the Colombian delegate spoke about the orbit of the OAS. It is, in effect, an orbit which gyrates around the U.S. An inspection by such delegates would be an inspection by the U.S. You talk about that the United States don't feel secure, and we ask the U.S., do we ourselves feel secure that we have no missiles against Cuba? Then cannot we reach an harmonious solution? Because the countries are equal in the world. Let's inspect all bases, atomic bases of the U.S., and let's inspect also what we have in Cuba. And if you want, let's liquidate all the atomic bases in Cuba and in the U.S., and we are in complete agreement with that.
Major Guevara, are you in fact trying to export your revolution? Are you every day shipping arms to other Latin American countries? Are you bringing revolutionaries from other countries to Cuba, training them, sending them home?
I also had an opportunity to say at the assembly, and I can repeat it emphatically now, revolutions are not exportable. Revolutions are created by oppressive conditions which Latin American countries exercise against their peoples. And there comes rebellion. And afterwards, new Cubas will emerge. We are not the ones who create revolutions. It's the imperialist system and its allies, internal allies, the ones who create revolutions.
But does not your attitude toward the present government of Venezuela, which is considered in many other countries leftist and progressive, suggest that you consider any government oppressive which is not communist?
In absolute, no. What we consider is that the Venezuelan government is not a leftist government, has nothing of a leftist government. It's an oppressor. An oppressive government is a murderer. He murders them in the peasant fights in the region of Falcon, for example, where there are military advisors of the U.S. There is in Venezuela today, in spite of the American press does not reveal it.
Is there any
Venezuelan government is not a leftist government.
Is there any government in this hemisphere which Cuba considers to be progressive?
The word progressive is an ambiguous word. There is one government with which we keep diplomatic relations, the government of Mexico, with which we have good relations. Our systems are different. We respect their system. We are in a complete harmony up to the date, and I have the hope that it will continue like that. But if you ask me the image of Latin America, there are some countries which oppress their peoples much more, and among the least oppressive, among those which we could have perfectly normal relations without any difficulties, we could have Uruguay, Chile, maybe Costa Rica, but the U.S. do not permit us.
But all these countries have broken diplomatic relations with Cuba. Don't you feel yourself isolated when you have no friend at all in this hemisphere?
We have a lot of friends, but not among the governments. The friends are in the peoples. And in the last instance, the peoples will be the rulers of those states.
That's it for Africa Woke Now Project for this week. I would like to thank you for joining us today and look forward to spending time with you next week. Follow us on Twitter at AFWRLDNWPRJ. Instagram at Africa Woke Now Project. Access to our other media platforms can be reached through the bios of our social media. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. The Africa Woke Now Project Collective consists of international media journalist, executive producer, and human rights activist Moise Muntali, Africa Woke Now Project media correspondent Funa Ngonda, senior research content contributor and production director Dr. Tasneem Siddiqui, senior research content contributor and production associate Dr. Josh Myers, associate producer and content contributor Dr. Keisha Khan Perry, content contributor and filmmaker Kurt Waterson, technology advisor is Byron Gray of Grayworks Technologies, and creative directors, international creative and artist designer Tabassum Siddiqui and Judah Pope. Africa Woke Now Project can be heard every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on WSNC, NPR affiliate and broadcast service of Winston-Salem State University. Programs are archived and available on all podcast platforms. Search Africa World Now Project. Until next week, be safe, be peaceful, and above all, be intelligent.